Just last week, Hong Kong shut down its largest and most infamous Vietnamese boat people camp, the Whitehead Detention Centre. The move signifies the end to the boat people saga in the territory. At least that's what authorities are saying. But there's a chapter that's still wide open. And ironically, it's the official refugees who are in limbo. Inside Story went to Tuen Mun's Pillar Point camp before the new year meant new management there. Susan Yu caught up with those urging for the Tuen Mun Centre to be scrapped before they called it quits. And she finds out why the refugees' chances of resettling here and abroad are slim at best.
Behind the trees and the fences lies a hidden population. Welcome to Pillar Point Vietnamese Refugee Center. It's an open camp. These are the boat people who've been screened in as official asylum seekers. They're the lucky ones, you'd think, just waiting for word, waiting to be resettled. They come and go as they please, but in reality, their destinations are unknown.
These are where we keep all the office records. So if we look at any one block in particular, like this one, it's actually got blocks 24 and 25. We've got all the records in here for everybody living in those blocks.
Meet James Jins. He manages the camp where little more than half of the 1,246 refugees in Pillar Point's caseload actually reside here.
The majority of them, I think, are in Hong Kong probably to stay. And we feel that they need to be encouraged to go and move out into the town and settle.
Why? To evict them from a protective environment. Some believe breeds complacency and bad habits like drug addiction, as Hong Kong's handover date nears.
I think nowadays the people care. It's resettlement. Yeah, they scare at 1997.
Win Man Chong knows the feeling all too well. The 35-year-old will be migrating to Australia.
So most of them nowadays despair for their resettlement because some of them have conviction. They do something wrong in Hong Kong. So they are very disappointed about their resettlement.
They are the 700 or so residents at Pillar Point. Of that number, a third are drug addicts.
When you're living since years on the premises of resettlement, by example, where you are living with a 1 month renewable ID card, how can you build future for yourself, for your family, and for your children? I think this is certainly part of the question and the problems that the drug users have been sinking in.
I feel that they shouldn't be left in limbo at Pillar Point without having some indication as to the likelihood of resettlement and some indication about what to do for the future.
The problem there is that some of these people have criminal convictions. Some of these convictions are very serious, some others are not. So we will, as I repeatedly said, press upon the resettlement countries, telling them this is really the last chapter of the boat people saga.
Some argue it's time for the Hong Kong government and the UNHCR to start helping these refugees integrate into society now, before waiting until the handover, and for China to make a decision on their future.
It's a horrible word. This is the residual caseload. And, you know, the faces you see in Pillar Point, the men, women and children, fall under this category.
And what's also difficult, deciding whether to close the center. But what complicates things is that about 600 non-refugees released from detention on recognizance live at the camp and are stateless, since Vietnam refuses to take them back.
These flats have been empty for a very long time, and they reflect one school of thought, and that's Pillar Point should be shut down. The sooner the better. Some believe it'll mean a wake-up call, not only for refugees, but also for authorities.
About 2 months ago, St. Stephen sent out this press release stating why it's quitting the UNHCR. It also criticizes the authorities on the whole of having no initiative to help the refugees and leaving them in a state of limbo, unrealistically waiting to be resettled, while many maintain drug habits and idle away their time in subsidized and relatively sheltered environment. And as one UN official put it last July, the refugees, especially the children, are social victims of Hong Kong's absurd legal system.
Anytime a direction is defined, we use the curriculum, manipulate it so that it will be useful and good for the children, preparing them towards whatever decision politically is being made for their future.
And with that future so uncertain, educators have their bases covered in the classrooms. Teachers use English, Vietnamese, and since September, Cantonese as the languages of instruction.
Can you tell us why you suggested that Pillar Point be shut down for good?
Yeah, we put that to the UN and to the government earlier on in the year. And it's something that's being talked about throughout the year. The reason for it is that I think most of us working with the people know that the majority of people here aren't going to be resettled.
Currently, about 164 refugees are in prison for offenses ranging from drugs to theft. Nearly three-quarters of that number broke the law when they were residents at Pillar Point.
Do you think that there's been just too much negative publicity about Pillar Point to the detriment of the residents? Is that what you're saying?
What I say is that recently Austria has taken 45 persons, and that if each country would take a similar or a smaller number, we would be already solving good part of this problem. What I'm saying is, by always emphasizing the problems we are having in Pillar Points of criminality, of drug addiction, we are shooting ourselves in the foot.
The UNHCR will stick it out to June 30th, 1997, as far as pushing to get these people resettled.
Yes.
And then including the residual cases, and then after that?
Then we will have to see. We will have to see with the Hong Kong authorities, with China, what will the course of action be after June 97? And as I said, I cannot speculate at that time.
Shouldn't that be discussed now, though?
You see, the Chinese have clearly indicated us that as far as they are concerned, they want to have no Vietnamese left at the moment of the handover. So I think it would be not appropriate to discuss this issue now.
But last March, the UNHCR gave its full endorsement to have Pillar Point shut down. And a month after, its stand was made clear to the Hong Kong government. Later, the security branch informally rejected the proposal. For rights advocates like Pam Baker, that's all the reason for people to read between policy lines when it comes to refugees and non-refugees alike. Today, she visits Whitehead Detention Center to brief those screened out what their chances are for freedom. She acknowledges the battle continues, even for those screened in.
What you first of all got to see is the political will on the part of the government to allow them to integrate. That doesn't exist. So that's what one has to work on first, to ensure that their rights as prospective citizens are observed, and certainly start with the ID, school for the children, enable them to move out. I mean, you can't keep people in an environment like that indefinitely. It's bad for everybody.
it's unlikely that they will be resettled by June 30th, 1997. What's going to happen to these people? Should the Hong Kong government take some kind of responsibility?
Well, for the moment, of course, the durable solution, to use international jargon, the durable solution for the refugees in Pillar Point is resettlement overseas. And that is something that we will pursue until the very end. Now, it may be that some of them will not be resettled. But in the meantime, I don't think it would be appropriate for us, for example, to consider their reintegration into the community.
Why not?
Because that would send a very wrong signal to the very countries we're hoping that will take some of these people.
Back at Pillar Point, sunset. Another day goes by, along with hope. It seems those who try to escape uncertainty in the first place find themselves, ironically, coming full circle.
Welcome back to Inside Story. More than a third of Pillar Point's resident population are children. And it seems it's the children who are paying the highest price as they and their families are waiting to be resettled. Inside Story's Susan Yu tells us how innocence is easily lost as many struggle with the harsh realities of life in and outside the camp. And she reports on why getting protection for the most vulnerable can be even more difficult.
For Pham Bao, this is a typical night. The 14-year-old is accepted as one of the grown-ups here. He looks after his 8-year-old brother Pham Thai and 3 other siblings. He cooks for them. That's if they have food to eat. Where are the parents? The mother is rarely home. The father is in prison. Their story is not uncommon. Later in the evening,
she hasn't seen her mommy since this afternoon, and she's been told that her mommy's been outside. And she's got no idea when her mommy will be back. So she sat there cold, has nothing to eat, and crying.
James, is this quite common?
It happens, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say it happens to all children here, but some children, yeah, certainly. How long has her mother been away?
She thinks that about 6 o'clock.
But tonight, her mother does show up, about 4 hours after leaving her alone. At the camp's playroom, some children find temporary shelter.
Normally during the day, they go to school, but during the evenings, they come here and play, so it's good.
She and her 2-year-old son will likely resettle in Australia. Leaving the camp and the children behind will be hard.
I think about the future of these kids. It's so sad for them to stay here. I love them all and I consider them like my own.
Her feelings are shared by several so-called caregivers in the camp. Their role? To look after unattended children, whose parents have decided to live outside Pillar Point or are in prison. But it's the youngsters, many believe, who ultimately pay the price. Across the way, an evening drawing class is in full gear.
I would imagine there's a longing somewhere inside. They don't know what it's for, but they'd like it to be different. Most of them have some very difficult problem in their family. They might have a father who's a drug addict or who's in prison. Occasionally there's children with both parents in prison.
Out of the 250 children who live at Pillar Point, about 43 fall into the high-risk category. 15 of those are on St. Stephen's priority list. For the past 2 years, resident baker Win Van Trinh has made it his priority taking care of these 2 children whose mother is in prison.
Cái lớp trẻ, cái để con quật ở ngoài trại đấy mà không cha không mẹ không cơm nước mà thì bắt đầu gây ra muốn tình thương.
The mother of the youngsters was released just days after we spoke to Win Van Trinh. She now has custody of the two children and another two-year-old daughter who lived with an acquaintance outside Pillar Point. When Thi Huế tells us, though, her situation is not by choice.
Trong thời gian sống xa con thì ở trong lương tâm thì có khổ về xa con về nó là do trong thời gian xa con ấy thì chẳng có gì làm cho em để quên được những lời những niềm thương con cả không làm không thể làm gì.
Win Van Yan and his wife knows it isn't easy raising children in a camp environment and making ends meet. They've been here since 1991.
We had financial problems, so Caritas told us if we help look after some of the children, we can get paid for it.
The Wins have been looking after this six-year-old boy for 3 years now. Although they get $600 a month to carry out parental duties, they say that isn't the sole reason for taking up the offer.
It's irrelevant to me whether it was raising my own child or not. You feel so badly, you just want to look after them.
In fact, some caregivers have wanted to officially call the children their own. But under Hong Kong law, they're not allowed to do so.
In October, the government reviewed its adoption ordinance. After the case of 20 unaccompanied children at High Island Detention Center was brought to its attention, it later reaffirmed its stance that Vietnamese migrants are not Hong Kong residents technically, and therefore they are ineligible to officially adopt children at the camps.
However, there's been one exception.
We took an adoption for a childless couple in High Island whose neighbor had a daughter of 14 who was raped, and the 14-year-old had a baby, and this childless couple took the baby and they wanted obviously to adopt her. So we tried to get the social welfare department to do what it always does on adoptions, and it took advice from the Attorney General's chambers, and the Attorney General's chambers advised the Social Welfare Department that they couldn't, that the law, the adoption ordinance said they couldn't. I disagreed with that advice and we went ahead and we actually succeeded in an adoption for that baby.
We've drawn the attention of the courts to this adoption and to the procedures.
Is that a problem? Is that a problem as far as the courts, how they're...
Well, I mean, I don't actually know what the consequences of, you know, I mean, it was an oversight on the part of the judge.
What we've asked for is that local social services get involved in their cases and offer them longer-term solutions, which may include foster care, which may include access to small group home, for example, if they are seriously neglected. An adoption would then be a possible future follow-up. I know the policy is against that at the moment.
Of the 15 high-risk cases the UNHCR has passed on to the Social Welfare Department, many involve children allegedly abused, some sexually.
What are the chances of the Hong Kong government giving you a concrete answer?
I hope we will get one very soon. This is what I can tell you. I mean, we have, for us, the matter is not a closed one. So we are still, even not later than last week, made some démarche with the Hong Kong authorities. So we hope that we will get a response.
If there are problems in Pillar Point, UNHCR, the management, the NGO, are responsible for dealing with those problems. But we have always made it clear that if there are problems which can't be resolved by them, for whatever reason, they can refer them to us and we will take them on. It's not as if we're uncaring, we're inhumane, where children are at risk. We obviously have a responsibility.
While the UNHCR waits, behind these walls, police question a two-year-old girl who is believed to have been sexually abused. But for some, what's perhaps even more criminal is the fact that the authorities are unwilling to step in until only after an offense has been committed. That means the crime must come first, the protection comes later.
No matter how reluctant the social welfare department may be to get involved, if a person is in Hong Kong and is subject to the laws of Hong Kong, that person is also entitled to the protection of the law. So if there's an abused child who is here, that child should be taken care of.
Would a child have to be actually neglected and sexually abused, and therefore the police would have to get involved to take a report, and therefore it becomes a responsibility of the government, and then it falls within the jurisdiction of the social welfare department? Is that what it has to, you know, is that what it has to take to get some kind of intervention? Do you see?
Well, it actually depends on the case, but yes, if you're talking about invoking the statutory duties under the protection of juvenile children and juveniles ordinance, then we do need substantial justifications for us to make such statutory intervention.
If a child is in a very difficult position, regardless of whether or not it's a refugee child or a Hong Kong child, then do you think you personally think it's a fair system at all?
And actually, it's very difficult for the department or for us to assess, you know, sorry, guy.
So it's just there have been.
Because I think because it's very difficult for the department to advise on what is the best interest of this child.
Sometimes our objectives are clashing with their objectives, and we know that the Hong Kong government is extremely reluctant to take any measure which could signal local integration for these Vietnamese. So we appreciate these political constraints. This is the reason why we are meeting with, as you call them, frustration.
Amid the frustrations, the children continue on, perhaps oblivious to what awaits them.